Welcome to Take the Lead Radio with Dr. Diane Hamilton, where she interviews some of the most successful leaders, entrepreneurs, authors, speakers, and other individuals who will inspire you to take the lead in your career and personal life. And now, here is Dr. Diane Hamilton.
Welcome to Take the Lead Radio. This is Dr. Diane Hamilton, and I'm so glad you joined us today because we have Michelle P. King here. Michelle is the author of The Fix, Overcome the Invisible Barriers That Are Holding Women Back at Work. She's an advocate for fixing workplaces, not women, and a podcast host of The Fix. So I'm really excited to have Michelle on the show today, and we're going to talk about what she does and her work, and I hope you stay tuned because this is going to be a really fascinating conversation.
Are you interested in finding out more about how HR professionals or leadership consultants can become certified to give the groundbreaking new Curiosity Code Index assessment? The certification program will provide the ability to administer the assessment at reduced rates. Participants will learn how to interpret the results of the CCI, as well as how to deliver an innovation plan workshop designed to improve curiosity, engagement, innovation, and productivity. To find out more, go to curiositycode.com.
I am here with Michelle P. King, who is a leading global expert in gender and organizations and director of inclusion at Netflix. Previously, she was the head of the UN Women's Global Initiative, a coalition for change. She spent her career advancing women in innovation and technology and leading global diversity and inclusion programs and advocating for women at work. It's so nice to have you here, Michelle.
Thank you so much. I love being here. Thank you.
Well, this is going to be fun. You have your own podcast, The Fix, so you're a pro at all this. But I was looking at your background. I mean, you really do a lot of speaking. You contribute regularly at Forbes. I mean, your work's been published everywhere, and you have a PhD and all the things that you have with your background. So this is going to be fun because we're going to have a lot to chat about.
Thank you.
Yeah, I gave a little bit of background, but for those who aren't familiar with you and your work, can you just give a little bit of background on how you got to be the director of inclusion at Netflix and have a podcast and do all this amazing stuff?
Yeah, look, I mean, I've had a very long career in human resources. I've worked in a range of countries in that space and with a bit of a focus on, you know, diversity and inclusion. And then probably after my second child, around 5 years ago, after the birth of my second child, I really wanted to dig deep into the equality space and really understanding, you know, why women aren't advancing at the same rate as men. And it was at that time that I got an incredible opportunity to work for the United Nations, for UN Women, and coming up with their strategy around diversity and inclusion, and then later on heading up their innovation and tech programs. And so it was really just through a lot of that work that I came to see, you know, how workplaces don't really work for women and what it is that we need to be doing. And so that's when I really started my work as a researcher, you know, undertaking my PhD to really try and understand this issue and, you know, what specifically we need to do to solve it. So that's kind of how I got to where I am today. And it was through writing the book that the opportunity with Netflix presented, and I've just joined them. So it's great.
Oh, that's awesome. Now, I know you have an MBA and a master's in psychology, but what's your PhD in?
So my PhD is actually looking at, you know, inequality in workplaces, but specifically as it relates to organizational politics. So really trying to understand how organizational politics differ men and women, you know, how they engage in that when it comes to things like networks, when it comes to things like, you know, mentorship, sponsorship, informal communications. So really trying to understand how inequality shows up for women, what are some of the invisible barriers that women encounter. So a lot related really to my book.
Well, tell me a little bit about your book.
Well, so the book, I started out, it was actually, I often share this story, about 3 years ago, I spoke at a conference in America, and I'd kind of just arrived in the States. I didn't know too much about this conference. It was in Pennsylvania. I mean, I didn't even know what Pennsylvania was, if I'm honest. And, you know, I just finished a huge sort of the first leg of my PhD around the literature review, right, and really looking at what some of the challenges other women encounter at work. And it, through that work of reviewing thousands and thousands of academic journals, it became really clear to me that, you know, women are not the problem, it's workplaces. And by that I mean, like, you know, the studies are showing that women are really capable just as they are. They're great at networking, they're great at leading. You know, men and women rate women as high in terms of their networking ability, in terms of, you know, their leadership capabilities and their management capabilities. And so some of that came as a shock because, you know, I very much bought into the lean in school of thought. So I, you know, I'd assumed that women needed to do things differently to advance, or women needed to do more, be more, right? Mm-hmm. And so I was actually looking for that fix. I was wanting to understand what I needed to do to advance in organizations. And so in reading all of that, it was really surprising. And in learning how workplaces are designed, you know, by and for men and the challenges that that creates for women, I was like, you know what, I've got to share the story. And so I get to the conference thinking it's going to be like 200 people. Turns out it's America's largest conference for women. There's about 17,000 attendees. Uh-huh. Michelle Obama's like opening the session. I was like, oh my goodness. Anyway, you know, and I that day, you know, I get up, I present my findings, and it was an audience of women, you know, who were so eager to understand what they needed to do, what was wrong with them, what they, how they needed to fix themselves, that they were all holding some notepads and pens. And I was like, oh wow, you know, this really is real. This is something we do. We try and fix women, right? And so right. I'm presenting all of this information, and I noticed the notepads and pens kind of get put to the side. And heads are like nodding, you know. And when I finish my talk, I come off stage. There's a group of women lined up to introduce themselves. And one woman was really red in the face and she looked kind of upset, you know. And as she comes up to me, she puts both her hands on my shoulders really intensely and sort of stares into my eyes in dramatic fashion and says, I'm going to put up on my wall at work what you said. And I was like, what did I say? And at this point, there's like tears, you know, coming, rolling down her cheeks. And I was like, wow, what is going on? And she said, I'm going to put up on my wall at work what you said, which is that I don't need to be fixed and I'm good enough just as I am. And it was in that moment, you know, it's like still gives me goosebumps today, that I knew I had to write this book. I was like, you know, every woman everywhere deserves to know that it's not them, it's their workplace. Mm-hmm. But in a more positive way, that, you know, they really deserve a workplace that values them,
right?
Just as they are, right? And I don't think we tell women that enough in terms of their careers, that, you know, you deserve a workplace that values you. You really do. And so that's what started the journey. And I just wanted to write a book that didn't exist, which was one that documented all invisible barriers throughout a woman's career, that explained in plain English how gender inequality works, because most of us aren't aware, that explained the challenges that this creates for men as well, because that's one of the things we never talk about. And then importantly, why workplaces actually need this more than we do. In terms of, you know, the challenges that are coming with the future world of work and the need for cultures of equality. And if businesses don't get it right, they just simply won't be able to survive. And in, you know, a coronavirus world, that's now sort of more true than ever, right?
Right.
We really need inclusive leaders. And so we can talk about all of that. But that was really, you know, what I've found through my work.
Well, and the book "Nice Girls Don't Get the Corner Office" is, you know, a book that discovers, you know, that we're making, you know, the work of women is just not what we've been talking about all along, like you're saying. And you know, Arianna Huffington, I'm trying to put this in better words. That didn't come out very well, but you know, Arianna Huffington said, you know, that this work is passionate, practical roadmap for addressing inequality and finally making our workplaces work for women. So how are we doing this? What are these invisible barriers? I mean, you mentioned a few things I want to touch on, but I want to start with that.
Yeah, so in my book, I mean, I document 17 of the most common challenges women will encounter throughout their career. But a really simple way to look at it is, and it actually is part of the explanation of how inequality works in organizations, and is that in most companies, right, when we think of the ideal leader or the ideal manager, we think of a male. So that's been replicated across cultures and geographies over 30 years. That research has found that. And that's still true today, right? But it's not just that we think of a male. We think of like what I call the Don Draper prototype, right? This is like, for if you've watched Mad Men, you know, it's a reference to Mad Men. 1950s white middle to upper class male who's heterosexual, able-bodied, but importantly, like, is willing to engage in sort of dominant, aggressive, assertive, competitive and exclusionary behaviors to get ahead. It's also someone who's willing to make work sort of the number one priority, right? And so you have this prototype in organizations, and everybody's expected to live up to it by engaging in those behaviors, but the challenge is the more you differ from the prototype in terms of your race, ethnicity, sexual orientation, religion, physical, mental ability, age, the more barriers you're going to face trying to advance at work. So that is exactly how inequality works, because we have this prototype. It doesn't work for everybody in the same way. So the more you fit it, the more sort of privileged you are, because the easier it is for you to advance in workplaces, because you naturally fit the idea or the standard of what good looks like, right? And so this is really what creates challenges. And it's particularly difficult for women because, you know, while this might be the standard of what good looks like in workplaces, so to be seen as competent, you have to live up to the prototype. In society, to be seen as a woman, you have to engage in more sort of feminine, empathetic, collaborative, meek, mild, and assuming types of behaviors. And so to be seen as likable, you've got to engage in those more feminine behaviors. But to be seen as competent, you've got to engage in more Don Draper behaviors. And the problem is the two don't marry, right? And so for women, there's sort of no right way to show up at work. Because if you're dominant, you're not going to be likable. But if you're unassuming, you'll be likable, but you won't be competent. So, you know, one of the very first challenges women face is this conformity bind, right? So it's this challenge of living up to the two requirements that don't really marry. And so for me, the interesting thing in my research is men also face this challenge in the sense that for them, their masculinity is tied to Don, right? So for them to be seen as a man and be seen as competent, they've got to live up to Don. But if they engage in sort of more feminine behaviors, which are actually often more effective when it comes to leading, like being empathetic and inclusive and collaborative and democratic, you know, they will be labeled, given the sort of femininity stigma, and seen as more feminine and not taken as seriously. So this, it's really handcuffs that these standards create in workplace. They handcuff us. They prevent us from sort of stepping outside of these prescribed gender roles. And the challenges for women is it affects how we're seen in terms of our competency and how much we're valued at work. But for men, I think long term, it really impacts their effectiveness, because they can't sort of deviate from Don. So that's, you know, put simply, just one example of a barrier. But ultimately, every barrier that I outline in my book comes back to this, that workplaces need to get rid of this prototype and really look at how do you become sort of more of an organization built around values and give people the freedom to demonstrate those values in a range of different ways. So that's really what my work aims to achieve, is looking at, you know, how do you create a workplace that values inclusion, that values difference, and really supports employees to engage in a wide range of behaviors.
Well, you brought up so many great points. My dissertation was on emotional intelligence and its impact on performance. And so empathy is a big part of emotional intelligence. And we know, you know, from Goldman's and others' research that empathy and developing emotional intelligence is really important for success in leadership. But I agree that men do have that sense that, you know, they have to be a certain way. And I saw that a lot in certain industries more than others, and certain age groups more than others, just in my personal experience. I'm curious if you're finding it differs, you know, based on generation, based on just industry.
You know what's so funny is for my first, I'm going to totally geek out here for your listeners, for my first master's degree, I did it in emotional intelligence. And I actually surveyed, I was looking at emotional intelligence and stress. So I actually surveyed about 150 CEOs Is when I was working in New Zealand. And at the time, as many years ago now, it was sort of the first sort of online survey, right? So interviewed all these, surveyed all these leaders. Mm-hmm. And what is interesting is actually bringing it back to your question is one of the key barriers I've found for men is that, you know, this inability to deviate from Don, right, and engage in more sort of inclusive, collaborative, supportive behaviors, challenges men because it's difficult. They're isolated, right? They're not encouraged to speak up about their different experiences. They're not encouraged to display that empathy because all of that is seen as sort of deviating from what the ideal is at work, but also the ideal in terms of what it means to be a man. And so I always say, like, the number one thing we need from men in terms of them, you know, supporting equality is for them to really think about what it means to be a man at work, because the silence costs men. So in my research around stress, I found that, you know, exactly this, when men can't share and can't speak up and can't talk about their challenges and be vulnerable and, you know, demonstrate that empathy to build the relationships, it causes them stress, you know, the isolation they face in not talking about what's worrying them at work and not talking about their difficulties or their challenges. And, you know, it leads to really high risk taking behaviors because they kind of have to make decisions on their own that are often quite risky, right? And then have to manage the consequences of that on their own. And so it creates this very toxic, stressful environment at work, but also at home, because, you know, men are encouraged through the breadwinner image to, again, carry that load on their own, right? And not talk about the challenges that they face. So I think there's a lot of difficulties around male silencing at work, and also how men are bullied to conform to that silence. So it's very interesting because while men may have all these male networks, right, that sort of support from a advancement perspective, they don't actually have the true sort of social support at work in terms of people they can talk to and be vulnerable with and, you know, talk about their challenges. And that's why we see really high rates of stress with men. We also see higher rates of suicide and depression. And so I think this is what we're seeing in terms of the consequences of living up to these sort of outdated ideals.
Well, and by generation, was it different?
You know, what's interesting is I think I always get asked that question, right?
Yeah.
And around generational pieces. Mm-hmm. And I think my book really talks to this and showing more recent research that, you know, there's loads of Pew research that's come out to show that actually we still today hold these ideas in terms of what good looks like for men and women and what good looks like at work. And so a lot of it is, it, even though we like to think that, you know, men are doing more at home, they are, like, in, you know, compared to Don in the 1950s, but it's still a lot lower than what women are doing, right? So it's all mm-hmm. it's all relative. And so I think the challenge is, you know, when men come into the workplace, they're socialized, and I think we forget that. So even if, you know, you educate men and, you know, you support them to champion equality at work, I mean, I talk about my own husband, you know, I'm a feminist. I mean, I literally train him on this stuff on a daily basis. And, you know, he still, when he goes to work, feels that pressure because of the social environment to conform, right? And right. So he found it hard, even as a very senior, I mean, he's literally fits the prototype, right? He's Don, to go in there and just tell them that he was taking his son to the doctor. You know, he wanted to make up an excuse around that and hide his identity outside of work because it's not what Don does. And so right. This is really challenging. And I was like, well, if it's difficult for you, imagine how much harder it is for women. And, you know, so we really need to break the male silencing at work. We really need to sort of give men that freedom to talk about the challenges now more than ever, as men are taking on more at home, about the challenges of integrating work and home life. And I think if men can do that in their, you know, slightly more privileged positions, it does make it that much easier for all women really to do the same.
Well, it's interesting that you studied the stress level. I actually picked Reuven Baron's EQI for my research to focus on stress because I was looking at salespeople. But I think that stress is so important to look at, of how people react in certain ways. And I think that I'm thinking of my experience in different industries, going back to the industry question a little bit. You know, what I found, just my generation and the industries in which I've worked, the people I've worked with, the men I've worked with, have somewhat tried to, they're always nice and respectful to me, but I felt like, you know, I'm going to be the first one they're going to give the administrative task to. You know what I mean? That,
yeah.
This is girl work. You know what I mean? And they're above doing the girl work. And you never see the guys on the committees that are handling the girl work. Do you see a lot of that?
Yeah, look, I mean, office housework is a major issue. And interestingly, I mean, we haven't even begun to talk about race and sort of gendered racism and how that plays out at work. But we know this is an issue that adversely impacts Black women in particular in organizations, right? So taking on sort of office housework, being asked to do like, you know, take meeting notes or manage birthdays or, you know, any of those sort of administrative invisible activities in workplaces. And it creates huge challenges because, you know, people who are underrepresented in organizations, who are in sort of more, who tend to be more marginalized, it's harder for them to advocate for themselves. And so, you know, the lean in school of thought would say, well, you know, just speak up and say, I don't want to do it. It needs to be, or I want it to be more fairly shared across the team, or this isn't right. But studies show, again, when you do that, you're perceived as being difficult, right?
Right.
You are seen as like not being a team player. And so it's this very tricky situation. Whereas, you know, for me, being firmly in the fixed workplaces school of thought, I say, well, with something like that, let's actually make the sort of invisible visible. Let's list what those activities are. And then let's rotate it across the team so nobody has to ask. And so it's more equally distributed. And something we do in my team, right? So we just rotate it. So different people keep time, different people keep notes, and different people run the meetings. And we do that as a way of sharing sort of invisible tasks. But I think it takes a willingness on leaders to look at, you know, how are things not working for everybody, and being open when employees do raise it to hear them and try and think of solutions from a design perspective in terms of how you can fix it. I mean, equal pay is another one, right? I talk about in my book.
Yeah.
It's such a frustrating issue because consistently studies show if you're transparent about your pay data, the gap closes. Like, this is not complicated. And if you think about it, you know, from a commercial sense, if you are publishing your pay data in terms of like where the gaps are, you're accountable then for closing it, right? Because everybody can see it. And so you've got companies like Verve and, you know, bigger ones that I think Adobe, where they've published this data and it helps to just close the gap. Like it just closes almost, you know, almost instantly, because companies just have to take measures to do that. And so I think a lot of this, and like that's the whole aim of the book, is like just bringing it to light, you know, making people aware. There's so many people who are in denial around gender inequality in workplaces, who believe that workplaces are meritocracies and that they function for everybody in the same way. And that's simply not true. Like, success discriminates, and it discriminates based on how closely you fit this prototype. And, you know, that's why the pay gap exists, which is something that I explain in my book. You know, we simply don't value men and women's contributions in the same way. And so the aim is to make people aware and understand what actions they can take. But most importantly, to hold leaders accountable for creating environments that, you know, do value difference, and where we do remove the barriers and take active steps to do that together.
I'm thinking of jobs I've had versus my leader's pay kind of thing. And I remember having a job where I made like 70,000-80,000, and the guy one step above me made $1,000,002, you know. You're going, wait a minute.
Well,
I did more than this guy did, right? And you look at that, and there was no way that they were going to put a woman in that position. They made that really clear by, you know, overlooking a woman who was doing a great job temporarily while they looked for a guy to replace her with. And, you know, it's so challenging for some, you know, in some industry. What do you do when you work for a company like that? Do you quit? Do you make a stink about it? What is the thing you do if you're in that position?
Yeah, it's really tricky, right? Because people, like, I get the pressure, right, to give the people love the lean in concept because it's empowering, right? This idea that I alone can fix my workplace and I can overcome it, and, you know, inequality might happen to some people, but it won't happen to me, and if it does, I can manage it. But that's actually the flawed thinking. That's actually what creates the problem, because what we notice is when you enter your workplace with that belief, which most women do early on in their careers, their confidence in their ability to reach senior leadership positions within the first 3 years falls by more than 60%. And the reason for that is because you do get fed that message of like, hey, I can do this, I can overcome it, because we like that message. It makes us feel good, right? It's the individualistic idea. And we forget the environment you're working in. We forget how it's rigged. We forget how bosses really determine success, and, you know, how a lot of them have very, very clear ideas of what good looks like. That tends to be met. We forget all of the challenges women encounter. And so we see that massive drop off on confidence. And that's why I say the number one thing all of us can do around managing work environments that are difficult is to realize it's not you, it's your workplace. And by that I mean, like, understand the barriers, know what they are, and think about the ones you've encountered along the way, so that when they do show up, you can see them for what they are. And that literally, as easy as that sounds, it's not that easy, because you've got to do the work. You've got to put in the time and effort to become aware of what those challenges are. And then I think, you know, the second thing is to think about how we can be allies to one another. I mean, sure, you can advocate for yourself in terms of speaking up, shedding light on the barriers, and holding leaders accountable for taking action. But that's very hard to do when, like with your example, you know, you're in a work environment that's not valuing you. And so I think there's a real opportunity here for women in particular to be allies to one another. And I've seen this happen really effectively. It's something I do, I practice myself, and I've seen other women do it. You know, there's something when women advocate for one another and call out these challenges for one another. I mean, the case of the office housework, right? I've had a colleague in one of my organizations that I worked at who was a Black woman who, again, regularly, I mean, literally textbook, right, regularly was tasked with this. And once I knew the barrier and I knew that this was something that happened, I was more aware of it and I called it out. And that was the opportunity to think about, hey, how do we make this, you know, more equal? And so I think really the aim is to try and get women to advocate for one another. I mean, in that situation, you might have had an ally. You might have had somebody to support you, or you might not have, because historically, you know, research shows women don't support one another. I mean, how many white women know the barriers that women of color face, and how it's so much harder, you know, when you have both race and gender sort of coming together and creating, you know, new experiences of inequality. And so I think, you know, what it is that we're wanting from men in organizations, we have to give to one another as women, which is to know the challenges we face, to be allies to one another, because it's incredibly difficult to navigate a work environment that doesn't value you and is constantly telling you it's you, and you engage in all the lean in, you know, behaviors and do more and get the qualifications and still not achieve, right? And so that can be very demoralizing. And that's why I think it's so important we come together and support one another. And, you know, in terms of allyship, it's calling out those barriers when they happen. It's advocating for one another. It's speaking up, and it's supporting one another. And I think that's the action that we need to take.
You know, as you're saying that, it brought to mind another situation in that same company. I was sitting at I had left, but I was back talking to them at an event. And the guy who was my boss was very open, sitting at the table, mentioning that, yes, we just promoted the woman that was on, not next to him, but on the other side of the person next to him. He goes, yes, we just promoted her because we needed to have a Black woman in leadership. He made it sound like that was her only thing. You know what I mean? And it was so bad that I was so stunned that somebody would say something so stupid, first of all. But then I looked at him, and I feel bad that I didn't say something. But, you know, what do? Do you start a fight in the middle of a restaurant? You know what I mean? And when you don't even work there anymore. And I look at some of this stuff, and I think, you know, it's so hard for women. Okay, say you have an advocate maybe with other women, but a lot of times you don't. I mean, we've had so many people on the show talking about how women hold them back the most because they're so competitive for so few jobs that, so what do you do about that?
I love this topic, and it's so funny. Whenever I talk about it, people are like, you're so brave. And I'm like, am I? Because I think this is just most people's experiences. So exactly what you're saying, so female-on-female misogyny, and a lot of that is the male lens, right? So in terms of how women are meant to relate to one another, I don't think women have defined that for ourselves, just like we haven't had an opportunity to define what leadership looks like for us, right? We're given Don Draper, and we're told that that's what we have to live up to. So we have to navigate this double bind of femininity and masculinity and how we do that and try and live up to it. And consistently, the research that I've looked at really shows that, you know, women leaders, the ones who are successful, they are a prototype. So generally, on average, you know, they tend to engage in Dom-Draper behaviors. They tend to be childless. So we find that, you know, there is a bit of a prototype around what women leaders look like. And a lot of it is those women who can conform to Dom. And so I talk about this in my book. I think for us as women, the challenge is really redefining what good looks like around leadership. And we're seeing examples of that with, you know, world leaders like Jacinda Ardern from New Zealand, right? That she's a prime minister there. And a lot of Americans know because of sort of the terrorist attack that New Zealand encountered last year and how she handled that with such empathy and compassion. And it was sort of a new approach to leading. And even now during coronavirus, right, she's really engaging in sort of a lot of empathetic, compassionate behaviors. And I actually interviewed her, and she's in my book, the interview around, you know, how she's approaching leadership and what matters to her. And she said the number one thing for her that she wants her government to be known for is kindness. And I've got to tell you, I've interviewed a lot of people, but that I literally just, when she said it, I was like, what? You know, this is not what I was expecting. But this is what I mean about building a values-based organization, right? So not the prototype in terms of what success looks like, but, you know, just being competitive and assertive and achieving and financial success and just having that sort of outdated notion of what good looks like. She completely redefined it and built it based on a value. And she was like, you know, this is what I want out government to be known for. And so everything hangs off the value. And so they look at different ways of really displaying that in terms of how the government is working. And whether you like her as a politician or not, that really is the future, is creating, you know, a value-based organization where you're clear in terms of what it is you're trying to achieve. And I think that, you know, my book clearly shows that women as leaders are exceptional. Like, we have the capabilities and the talents to lead in a different way. I just think we need to be conscious of how we're living up to the prototype. And in doing that, we don't support one another. And so women have to come together to be really clear about, you know, how we're going to do this differently and be brave in doing that and in knowing that in doing that, it's more effective. And so, you know, when we live up to this prototype, we don't support each other. We don't see each other. We don't understand our different barriers. And I think white women have an obligation to do this more than or any sort of woman from any other racial or ethnic minority group, because, you know, if you look at the history of feminism, it really was stolen. Like, white women stole it. White women liberationists did not really want to advance all women. They were interested in sort of advancing white women, particularly white women who best fit in workplaces. And, you know, those are women who conform to Don. And that's why when you look at the data on women leaders today, it's very clear that, you know, white women make up the majority of women in organizations because it's that much easier for them to fit that prototype. So we need to use that privilege and spend it by understanding the barriers that all women face and supporting one another.
Well, you talk about so many things that I think are really important and write about. And I think there's issues for all women, like you said, of color or not, just to get into some of these positions. They kind of get stuck in this catch-22. I think about women on board of directors, and California put in a law that, you know, that they wanted a certain number of women to be on boards now. And I've talked to some people, men and women, who get very upset by this. The men, of course, have some kind of, you know, like, why have them on if they're not as good as somebody else kind of mentality when I've talked to them. And then with the women, I've had some headhunter type women who were looking for people for boards. And the one I could think of said, you know, you need the most experienced person for these boards. And the people with experience are white men, and they're the CEOs. These are the ones we want. And that's just how it is. Why would I want to put a woman on a board who doesn't have as good of experience as a man? What do you say for that argument?
I have so much to say to this, so okay. I'm going to try and keep as brief as possible.
Go ahead.
So I just want to talk first about targets, and then I want to address the issue of leaders saying, I can't find these women, right, with the experience. So in terms of when we cut, copy and paste a woman into leadership positions, which tends to be follow like targets, organizations set targets for how many diverse hires they want, and then companies just plonk a woman into a leadership position and hope that they'll be successful, right? And that seems to be the way that a lot of companies have gone around trying to solve this issue of a lack of the diverse representation on leadership positions. I never used to have an issue with it until I did my own research. And now I have a very firm opinion on it, that it's just lazy. Mm-hmm. So it's lazy because it's a way to quickly increase your numbers of diverse representation, but actually do nothing to solve the lived experience of the workplace, do nothing to solve, you know, the crappy behaviors and the culture of the organization that doesn't support or value women. And so you can put a woman in a leadership position, but there's no guarantee that she's going to succeed or be valued or treated in the same way as her male counterparts, right? Mm-hmm. And so that's why, irrespective of your opinion on targets or your opinion on quotas or, you know, just putting women into these sort of token roles, the research finds it doesn't work. So even if you put women leaders in, there's a thing called implicit quotas. When you have one woman, you mentioned it before, you know, you're less likely, 50% less likely to have another woman because you've seen this already fitting this, you know, you've done your quota, you've done your diversity hire, you're good. And studies show women in leadership positions, like CEOs, irrespective of the firm's performance, whether it's good or bad, there's something like 63% more likely to be replaced by a man. And the reason for that is the prototype. We're just more comfortable with men in leadership positions. So, you know, this token hiring doesn't work, but also it's incredibly damaging. So my research has found that exactly to your point, when you have a woman in a leadership position and she's seen as a token hire, so we're just putting her there because she's a woman, you know, people perceive her as less competent. And remember, women are seen as less competent anyway because they don't fit the prototype. And so now she has to work so much harder to be seen as just, you know, average. So she has to outperform all her peers just to be seen as like deserving of the role. And so that creates a lot of pressure on the woman who's in that leadership position. And then, you know, outside of that, for men, this is one of the most damaging aspects of our diversity work today. So my research has found men cited the number one barrier to their advancement in organizations is diversity and inclusion initiatives that advance women or advance the interests of women. And that's because the message is, hey, this is a zero-sum game. This is about just advancing women at the expense of men. And that diversity and inclusion, it sort of becomes synonymous with that. Whereas research shows that actually in a culture of equality, it's an environment that values difference, what we find is men are twice as likely to advance to senior leadership positions and women are six times more likely. Now you might say, how could that be that everybody's advancing more? Mm-hmm. And it's because we're no longer advancing a small number of people who fit the Don Draper ideal. So we open it up. Everybody's got an opportunity to advance. And that's the thing that men miss, is even in the system that we believe works for men, it doesn't. So there's very few men who advance to senior leadership positions. And most of those who advance are the ones who fit Don, right? And so men have to really conform to try and get those senior leadership positions. Whereas the aim with a lot of the work that we're doing is let's open it up. Let's invite a range of behaviors. Let's give men and women an opportunity to advance in an environment that values difference. And so for me, this is more about how to create environments that can enable everyone to succeed and enables and values difference. Create that environment and then have a look, you know, your representation in many respects should start to take care of itself, because then you really are getting to more of a sort of a meritocracy where you're advancing people based on who's the most effective rather than people who most likely fit the prototype. The last thing I'll just say, based on, you know, this whole idea of exposure, right? So leaders saying, well, you know, I can't find women, I can't find talented women. And I get that crap all the time from leaders. And it's very frustrating because again, actually shows their bias. So talented women are out there. Let me reassure you, they are. The reason you're having a hard time finding them is because you don't know them. You're not exposed to them. So the work of leaders is not to be lazy and say this is a recruiter's requirement. The work of leaders is to diversify their network. That is something every leader should be doing. And organizations can enable that by having, you know, hosting dinners or hosting events where they give leaders access to diverse candidates. I mean, how many male leaders today know black women and know women from a range of ethnic and racial backgrounds who are really capable leaders and have a relationship with them that's established, so just like they do with white men, so that when the opportunity presents itself, you know, they can call them up and say, hey, why don't you apply? We'd like to consider you, or, you know, we'd like to invite you to be a part of this process because we think you're capable. That's the problem we need to solve for. And the interesting thing is the work I've done in previous organizations is when you really work on harnessing leaders' exposure. When you put them in environments with diverse, capable leaders, you're not only establishing their networks, but you're also changing their perceptions of what good looks like. So they have the prototype built into their head because they fit it. And that's their idea of what good looks like. And their networks tend to all look the same, right? This is a fact of how networks work. We like people who look like us. But when you get exposed to difference and you develop relationships, it challenges your assumptions. And over time, if you have enough of those relationships, you then can call on them not only from a recruitment process, but it also just starts to demystify this whole idea of, you know, what good looks like. And it starts to sort of challenge some of these leaders' ingrained beliefs. So it's really important exposure, you know, when you're hearing leaders say, I don't know them or we can't find them, which is probably the more common one. What it's really showing is that they haven't done the work to diversify their own networks.
Well, you know, I love a lot of everything that you're talking about. And I what you're saying, when you talk about challenging your assumptions, my research is in curiosity and getting away from status quo thinking. And, you know, there's four things that my research found that keep people from being curious, and they're fear, assumptions, technology, and environment. And as I'm working with a lot of large organizations, you know, pharmaceutical companies, you know, Verizon, well, whoever I work with, they're all trying to work on challenging some of this status quo way of thinking. And as I'm listening to what you're talking about, I'm thinking back to another job, and the men sometimes were more like they made it sound like, well, I'm a strategic thinker, you know, like I got the big overall ideas, but you could be, the woman could be the tactical, managerial more than leadership kind of people, because they like to do, we're back to the women work kind of thing. But I'm curious if you think that working virtually would change any of that, because I was thinking, as I still teach, I've taught more than 1,000 business courses, and I all my jobs I've had for online teaching originally, nobody ever saw me in the interview, nobody ever knew anything about me other than what they saw in a virtual paper setting, whatever it was. Do you think that women would fare any better in virtual work because you're not actually looking at me and having the female stereotype in front of you?
Yeah, look, I mean, I would love to think it was as easy as that, right? Because I think, it'd be great to say, look, let's just do this virtually and then all the stuff goes away. But we know through all the research and on bias in tech, for an example, that again, a lot of it's invisible, right? So when you look at how women are harassed just on social media and the bullying and the stats on that, it's, you know, I address a lot of these topics on my podcast, right? And how that is a huge issue for women, or just the actual bias in the design of tech and the design of apps, and how we just don't see women in terms of their needs or as end users, right? And so a lot of my work at the UN looked at that. And so I think the reality is, you know, irrespective of the platform we're using, there's always ways to exclude, to marginalize, and to discriminate, whether you're in person or whether it's on a VC and you ignore the contributions of somebody on a team meeting, or whether you're not even aware of the challenges that different groups are experiencing right now, you know, in this particular pandemic that we've all encountered, whether that's how this is a lot more challenging for women, because most women are tasked with managing sort of work and home life. And so for women who are now having to work at home and do schooling and do all the invisible labor at home, it's so much harder for them, right? Or whether it's, you know, the fact that a lot of Black women in America are particularly exposed to the virus, because a lot of them are in care positions. And so that's creating huge challenges in terms of, you know, their ability to get support, or, you know, the mental health issues that a lot of colleagues are facing right now that just kind of blind to, and that organizations still pushing workers to, you know, carry on as normal, but ignoring how it's differentially impacting all workers. So I think inequality can happen irrespective of whether you're working at home or whether you're working at work. You know, I just saw an article the other day where a woman was sharing how her workplace required her to dress up for VC meetings, just internal meetings, right? Uh-huh. And she was saying this is so hard to do because she has her kids and, like, the workplace, it's totally unfair. She has to wear the suit and then, like, run into the, you know, the lounge and feed her kids. And I was like, this is just outrageous. Like, you know, the fact that we're still doing this and then penalizing her again for not looking like she doesn't have children, right? And so I think this inequality can happen irrespective. And what we need is workplaces to see the whole person, right, is to see our identities outside of work, to understand the challenges we face, and to just talk about it, like just treat people like humans, you know, not expecting them particularly now to have to deal or show up like the prototype. I mean, it's just outrageous. So, you know, I think this can happen irrespective of where we're based. And the challenge is it just probably is a bit more invisible, right? So things like having to wear a suit or whatever it is, which is why we need people to talk about the challenges they're experiencing.
You know, I have a huge problem with business casual just because it is so focused on men being comfortable and women are still miserable. Because they all wear their jeans and Dockers or whatever that is that they like that are comfortable. And then there really isn't the equivalent for women. And if you did wear the equivalent, then you would be looked at as like, why would you wear that? You know, like women don't wear Dockers kind of thing. You know what I mean?
There's this hideous section in my book on this for women who, if you want to get really angry, read chapter 8. Chapter seven, where I share how women are expected to conform. So women aren't just judged in terms of their performance, they're actually judged in terms of performance and appearance.
Right.
And there's actually a very set formula for how women need to show up at work in terms of a suit, in terms of loose hair, no makeup, slight jewelry. Like, it's literally that prescriptive. Mm-hmm. And if you dress in that exact right way, and you have, you know, you'll then be seen as, and you perform, you'll then be seen as sort of acceptable in terms of your competence, right? Mm-hmm. Whereas men, you have Mark Zuckerberg with his hoodie and his jeans, and he just shows up and it's all fine. Uh-huh. And so, like, you know, you can't imagine a woman leading a large multinational wearing a hoodie and jeans. You just can't. Right, because mm-hmm. there's a different standard. And so that's a great example of, like, just purely on appearance, how women are judged in terms of their performance and capability. Whereas for men, you're not, it's not, it doesn't matter how you look, it's really just your performance. So it's incredibly challenging.
Yeah, I mean, the same thing in the speaking world. I've had a lot of Hall of Fame speakers have talked after the show and talked about why women aren't as much in the Hall of Fame and what, you know, you don't have as many what they consider the top quality speakers in women as men. And a lot of the guys have said, you know, they just get so over-criticized, what they wear, all the things that they would never do to a guy on the stage. And there's just so much to challenge that, you know. And I think it's keeping people in different categories, and that's what we're trying to get away from. And I know you interview a lot of women on your show about this, and I was looking at some of your guests. I mean, people, a lot of people would recognize Sarah Jessica Parker, Zoe Saldana, Kate Hudson, what, you know, the list goes on and on. I'm curious who you pick for your show. I mean, how do you decide who you want for your show, and what is your aim for going for the movie star people in that respect?
Yeah, so it's really funny, you know, the show's now, I'm in my third year, mm-hmm. and when I started it, I was actually writing for Forbes at the time, mm-hmm. and so it's like, and I was interviewing, my whole thing was interviewing high-profile people, whether they're academics, celebrities, thought leaders on topics related to gender and equality at work, right? Mm-hmm. And so that was sort of my niche with Forbes, and I just started recording it as part of the podcast. It wasn't the best format, I don't believe, but, you know, we just started that. And then about, I don't know, 6 or 8 months in, I was like, you know what, I don't really want to do this anymore. I think it's much more helpful to have what I see as sort of substantive experts. Mm-hmm. So while I'm happy to talk to sort of, you know, well-known people about their particular bent on it or what it is that they're trying to achieve when it comes to gender equality, I think the value is in substantive experts or substantive stories, right? People who've really done a lot of the hard work. And so the show sort of pivoted from you know, really just having high profile people to much more substantive experts. So getting in people that might be not as well known, but who, like Darnell Moore, who I interviewed like a couple of weeks ago, you know, who founded the Black Lives Matter organization. Mm-hmm. And he's got the most incredible story of nearly being set on fire for being, wow, you know, an individual who's part of the LGBTQ community, and for being Black, and his whole experience with that and how that then led him to do all his advocacy work now. And so you hear a story like that, or Teddy Quinlivan, who shares, you know, her story as to how she is a model but transitioned while being a model, and her whole experience with that and what it was like to sort of come out, you know, through CNN and have the whole world realize that actually, you know, you're a woman, and understanding what that means. And so, you know, you hear these incredible stories of people who've gone through things, or academics are sharing, you know, their latest research and insights. And for me, that's sort of what I'm most proud about the show as it is today, you know, when we really made that move to be, have a focus on substantive stories, the audience grew the most. And so it was kind of rewarding, because I think people want to have difficult conversations, they want to talk about these topics. You know, I read my book and I got a lot of pressure to dumb it down and make it just, you know, really easy read, and I think the publisher was like, why can't I just be like, lean in? I was like, no, you know, like, I think we need to have substantive conversations and talk about difficult topics. Like, I think women are ready and the world is ready to look at this stuff. So that's really, you know, how it's transitioned, and now I'm only interested in stories of substance.
Well, you know, my next book's on perception, and I think a lot of this ties into what I've been writing about. And I know I've had experts on my show that went by they, them, their. Are you dealing with that at all?
Yeah, so, you know, in terms of personal pronouns, again, my whole thing is, you know, fundamentally equality is about freedom. Mm-hmm. It just is, right? It's about the freedom to be yourself and to be valued for that. That is what this is for. This is a fight for freedom, and it's for freedom at work, and we need the freedom, right? But workplaces need the freedom, and, you know, personal pronouns are just one example of that. You know, we need to be respectful of people and what it is that, you know, how they identify, and personal pronouns are one way to demonstrate that respect. So whether you think it's silly, or whether you don't understand it, or whether it's, you know, not something that you yourself value, I think if we show that we value one another, we can do that by understanding how personal pronouns really indicate, you know, how somebody identifies. And we need to value our different identities just because you want to be valued, you know. So we need to practice that, and practice how we want to be treated by treating others that way, and take the time and effort to just understand what the personal pronouns are, and if somebody has a preference. And what you'll find that's really interesting when you do that is all the assumptions we make about how people identify and how challenging it is. And you'll see how ingrained gender norms are just in our language. I mean, it's really hard to get that right. And so I think we need grace. Like, we need to give each other grace, because we're going to learn. Like, I don't have this nailed, you know. I think the whole part of equality, and it's become difficult, right, in the diversity and inclusion space, is we're sort of seen as these sort of police force that goes out there and polices everybody, right? Like, really painful, and people get scared, right? They're like, oh god, I'm gonna get the pronoun wrong, I'm gonna get this wrong, I'm gonna say the wrong thing. And so nobody wants to talk about anything. When anybody raises something, it's seen as somehow labeling somebody as racist or sexist, and then that, you know, becomes somehow worse than the behavior that actually was, whether intentional or not, racist or sexist, right? And so it's just created this really challenging time where we're finding it hard to talk about things. And so for me, if we just give each other grace and not police each other, but actually try and develop the awareness and the understanding, and be really clear on what it is we're asking people to do and why, and how that supports creating an environment that actually all of us want to work in, that's how we'll get there. You know, when you understand why personal pronouns matter, you value them more, and then you try and understand how to put that into practice and what it is that's been asked of you, you can take steps to do that. And so for me, that's such a great example of where somehow in this it's felt like policing, and it's felt like, well, this is silly, I don't need to understand it, when actually that's not the case at all.
Yeah, and I think that's a great place to end. I think that there's so much that they can get out of your book. and from your work that you've done and all of your speaking and writing. And I was really excited to have you on the show, Michelle. Thank you so much for being on.
Well, thank you so much. I really, really appreciate it.
Oh, you're welcome. I was hoping you'd share ways they could connect with you if anybody wants to learn more. Do you have a link or how can they follow you?
Yeah, so I've got a website. It's Michelle, so M-I-C-H-E-L-L-E, P King. .com, and so you can sort of go on there, you can check out my site. I also connect with everybody on LinkedIn, and you can also check out my weekly podcast, The Fix.
Well, this is so much fun. Thank you again. And
thank you.
You're welcome.
Have a great day.
And we will be right back. Do you know someone who might benefit from taking the Curiosity Code Index assessment? The CCI is the first and only assessment that determines the factors that inhibit curiosity. It's simple. If you recommend the assessment to someone else, you can receive 20% of the purchase price that they pay when they take the CCI through the link provided by you. To obtain the link and become an affiliate, please go to drdianehamilton.com/affiliate. Well, I'd really like to thank Michelle for being my guest today. We get so many great guests, and I hope you check out her book, The Fix. She's got such great work out there. It gets so many wonderful authors and just individuals on this show. I hope you take some time to check them out. If you've missed any past shows, you can go to drdianehamilton.com. Of course, we play on all the podcast sites and the different AM, FM shows, stations where we air. But if you want to read the show, we transcribe it on my blog, and that's on drdianehamilton.com/blog. And what's nice is there's lots of tweetable moments, and anything that we talk to, including Michelle's book, will be linked to. So hope you check that out. And I hope you enjoyed today's episode, and I hope you join us for the next episode of Take the Lead Radio. You've been listening to Take the Lead with Dr. Diane Hamilton on C-Suite Radio.